I tell stories without words. I take people on a journey, on an emotional trip without saying any words. I can do it with music.
As a guitar geek, I'm willing to bet you have at least one guitar hero, if not an entire list of guitar heroes. Well, get prepared for that list to grow after today's episode, because we're focusing on Tommy Emmanuel today, my personal guitar hero, and if he's already not on your guitar hero list, he likely will be after today's Acoustic Tuesday episode. In fact, with a new album just being released on May 8th, the best of Tommy songs, and his birthday coming up at the end of the month, May 31st, I figured what better time to dedicate an entire episode of Acoustic Tuesday to none other than the acoustic man himself, Tommy Emmanuel. In fact, we're gonna kick things off with six lessons that I learned from Tommy Emmanuel. Some years ago, I had a chance to sit down with Tommy for an interview, and we talked about a ton of stuff in a short amount of time, just 27 minutes, but man, was it packed full of incredible goodness. I'm talking insight into the world of guitar and, well, life itself. So I want to share with you the six most important lessons I learned from that interview. Kicking things off with lesson number six, I asked Tommy about composition and arranging, how he approaches arranging songs as a solo guitar player. And he explained a very simple yet highly effective approach. This is what he had to say about arranging.
And can you tell me a little bit about your approach to dynamics? I mean, you seem to do it very consciously.
What I do is I think like a band and a singer. So when I'm playing a tune, the lead singer is here. Right? So that's the singer, and this is... That's the band backing.
Yeah, absolutely. So,
yes, indeed. Lesson number six is think like a band. Let's go ahead and move on to lesson number five. And this was actually taught to me after a question I asked him about how Tommy makes it as a solo act. He had a lot of insight, and he said that you have to make a certain type of sound. And here he is describing that very sound.
Do you find it hard? Or how do you make it as a solo guitarist? And I think that plays to that a little bit. Mm-hmm. Could you explain?
It's the same principle as anything else. You got to think like, I'm going to give these people everything I got. I never ever think like, well, I'm just a solo guitar player. How can I possibly, you know, see myself as being a huge success in the world? I've never ever thought that way. I've always thought, if you can't give these people a good time, get out of the way and let me on. You know, that's yeah. always been my attitude. And if you want a big crowd, make a big sound.
Lesson number five, make a big sound. Let's go ahead and move on to lesson number four. And this was an awesome one because I was witness to a sound check that Tommy did. And it spurred the question of how he approaches playing to different crowds, whether it's a crowd of 1,000, a crowd of thousands, or rather a crowd of just a few people. And here's how he approaches playing to, well, any type of crowd.
When I do sound check, like I had a crowded sound check today. You were there, yeah. Levi was there, Mr. DiMaggio was there, yeah. and it was a few people.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm not going to mess around at sound check. I'm going to really play because there are people there. So
Absolutely.
I don't want people to hear me sitting and, you know, playing half-assed.
Yeah,
you know?
Absolutely.
I'm going to play for them even though it's sound check, so.
Spoken like a true master, yes, lesson number four is don't half-ass it. No matter there are thousands of people watching or just a few close friends, do not half-ass it. Always go full throttle all the time. Let's move on to lesson number three, and this is one of the ones that really kind of hit me upside the head. As an obvious lesson, but one that I personally lose sight of. In fact, I'll explain more about that, but this particular lesson was taught to me when I asked Tommy where his mind was while he plays. And this is what he had to say.
You know, I try to always use the common sense approach.
That's good.
Look for a good melody and good chords and all that stuff.
Why do musicians overthink everything?
Well, exactly. You're out there. Don't forget, you're out there to play for the people. Yeah. You're not out there to try and impress musicians. You're out there to play for the people.
Yeah.
And if you do the job properly, you'll always have a good job. And people, what you want to hear at the end of the night is, when are you coming back? That's all you want to hear.
So lesson number three, play for the people. And this, again, this is such a simple lesson, but it smacked me right upside the head, because so often I'll be playing and I'll think, man, as a guitar player, what would I like to hear? This is a real guitar-y thing. Maybe I'll play that. That'll certainly light up the eyes and ears of a guitar player if they're listening. But bottom line, it doesn't matter who's listening. Play for whoever is there. Play for their enjoyment. Play for their entertainment. Make sure they have a good time. Play for the people. Lesson three, I think, is probably one of the most important ones on this list. Let's go ahead and move on to lesson number two, and this has a lot to do with guitar shopping. In fact, as a guitar geek, we go shopping for guitars quite often, whether that's digitally or in person. And I asked Tommy, how do you pick out the perfect guitar? And here's what he had to say.
That's outstanding.
You've got to find what works for you. People are always asking me, well, what's the best guitar? And I'm like, the one you can't put down. What are the best strings? The ones that your guitar likes.
Totally.
You know, the ones where your guitar feels so good, sounds so good, it's got overtones, it tunes up so well and all that stuff, you know. It doesn't matter what brand it is. Experiment, find out for yourself. It's up to us to make the decisions, you know. Just because the people see me in magazines or on TV doesn't mean that what I do works for you. You have to find what works for you. I'm just doing what works for me. And I'm still farting around looking for things to get to make what I do better.
Lesson number two, do what works for you. It doesn't matter who plays what or if you're trying to mimic a style. Yes, if that piece of gear works for you, use it. But if it doesn't, don't use it. Bottom line, do what works for you. Just because a certain set of strings and a certain type of guitar might work for one of your guitar heroes doesn't mean it will necessarily work for the way you play. So make sure you evaluate your guitar, your gear, as in what works for you, and follow the muse when it comes to that. Do what works for you. All right, let's go ahead and move on to lesson number one. And this one actually came up well after the interview took place. This wasn't a lesson we talked about in the interview. In fact, I've been lucky enough to interview Tommy Emmanuel on two separate occasions. One, as you saw, that video interview. In fact, you can check out that full video interview at acousticlife.tv/AT142. You can sink into all 27 minutes of it. And then about 2 years after that interview took place, I had a chance to talk to Tommy on the phone for, gosh, it was probably about an hour. We talked about practice habits. We talked about Chet Atkins. We talked about all sorts of things. And after that interview, things started to sink in. And then it really hit me when I received a phone call. Tommy actually called me to thank me for the time that he spent discussing guitar, talking about things, the laughs that we shared, etc. He took time out of his schedule to call me and thank me. And I thought this was just such a profound act of kindness. And that's lesson number one, is just be kind. Be kind to everyone. And I know that seems a little flowery, maybe a little altruistic, but it's true. Here's this guitar hero that I admire, that I place up on a pedestal. I think his guitar technique is amazing. His ability to compose, arrange is top-notch, almost mind-blowing. And he took time out of his busy schedule, between tours, between interviews, between shows, to call me and simply say thank you for spending time chatting. I thought that was insane and really left a huge mark on me. So that is lesson number one. Be kind. It doesn't matter if you're a top-notch guitar player or if you're a brand new guitar geek. Just be kind to your fellow guitar geeks and fellow human beings for that matter. In fact, that's one of the things that struck me is I admire Tommy for being my guitar hero, but also being just a top-notch, kind human being. And that's certainly a lesson that will stick with me for, well, the rest of my days. Now, speaking of lessons, as I mentioned, if you want to check out that entire video interview, you can do so at acousticlife.tv/AT142. We talk about a ton of different things in just 27 short minutes. The time flew by like that. And I can't recommend that interview enough. I just recently obviously rewatched it and was inspired again. And I want you to have that same sense of inspiration. In fact, as you watch that interview, if you see a lesson or if Tommy teaches you a lesson, go ahead and leave it in the comments below. In fact, Tommy has so many different interviews and things out online. I would love to hear what Tommy has taught you, whether it is in your guitar life or just in life in general. And if you can kind of wrap that lesson up in a nice little comment and leave it below, I would greatly appreciate it. appreciate it. All right, this week on Acoustic Tuesday, you've already received the Guide to Guitar Life from Tommy Emmanuel. We're also going to dig into one of my all-time favorite Tommy Emmanuel albums, and I'll share with you five of my favorite songs off of that album. Plus, you're going to hear a piece of gear that Tommy Emmanuel uses at every single live show. In fact, I cannot wait for you to hear it. Welcome to Acoustic Tuesday, episode 142. This is the show where you're going to learn about acoustic guitar gear, discover acoustic artists, and get inspired to live your very best acoustic life. As with all episodes of Acoustic Tuesday, I'm going to share with you my guitar geek list for the week. And yes, as I mentioned already, today's entire episode is dedicated to Tommy Emmanuel. And as you know, if you've watched Acoustic Tuesday for a while, we have a very important order of business, and that, of course, is Guitar Geek Trivia. We have to kick off the show with our Guitar Geek Trivia question, and I thought to myself, well, if the entire show is dedicated to Tommy Emmanuel, we certainly must dedicate the trivia question to Tommy Emmanuel as well. In fact, we're going to be dedicating this trivia question to the guitar that Tommy Emmanuel favors. Without further ado, here is your Guitar Geek trivia question for the day. In which year was the Australian guitar company Maton Guitars founded? Was it A, 1946, B, 1952, C, 1959, or D, 1972. Go ahead and ponder that, and at the end of the show, I will, of course, be giving you the full answer with a little bit of a story behind it as well. And I'm excited for that, but we have other things to tend to. In fact, as I mentioned before, Tommy just released a new album on May 8th, and it's entitled The Best of Tommy Songs. And this is a really cool moment for Tommy. And I'm maybe speaking out of turn here, but I think it's a cool moment because it's a chance for Tommy to not only look back at his entire catalog and select some really important and awesome songs to re-record, but also to introduce to all of us some brand new songs. So I am super excited for this album. And I often think, gosh, what does an artist feel like when they're going into recording an album like this? Well, Tommy was one step ahead of me because he recorded this wonderful little trailer to this new album that kind of shares where his mind was at. So let's have a look.
I tell stories without words. I take people on a journey, on an emotional trip without saying any words. I can do it with music. A writer like me needs to be really inspired. And when inspiration strikes, you need to be ready. You need to have your sword sharpened. So, you know, I've got my guitar with me all the time. I don't think like a guitar player, that I'm writing a song for a guitar player at all. I think I'm writing a song for a singer and a band. I'd been writing some songs in the last year, and instead of doing like an anthology project, I thought it would be great to revisit some of my early songs and redo them and put the new ones in as well and make it a kind of mixture and make it a focus on my songwriting. And then I thought, well, these songs sound like me and I don't write like anyone else, so they're Tommy songs. I'm not really a purist at heart. I believe in letting the music, playing the music how you feel right now. And I hope that in 50 years' time, if someone picks up Tommy songs, they'll go, who's this young fella? Wow, I like the sound of his guitar. And wow, did he really write all those songs? Not bad for a kid. Yeah, that'd be good.
What What an awesome approach to an album, and how cool to be able to have this wonderful catalog of songs to look through, to sift through, and choose a few choice ones to re-record. And it got me thinking, you know, Tommy's got this new album coming out, kind of this career retrospective kind of a vibe, and I thought, when did I first hear Tommy Emmanuel? And it was his album called Endless Road. This is an album that I would recommend for any acoustic guitar geek, period. It's the first Tommy Emmanuel album that I heard, and it's the one that had a huge impact on me. So I thought, with Tommy's new album coming out, and this being my favorite Tommy Emmanuel album of all time, the first one I ever heard, I want to select 5 songs off of the Endless Road album to share with you and kind of explain to you why I think they're, well, top-notch. So let's dig right into that album. The first song that I want to select and share with you is the song, the title track, Endless Road. This is a song that, wow, it just captures any guitar geek's attention, and I'm sure you will agree with me. Let's give it a listen. There you have it, Endless Road. What a great song, a song with an incredibly catchy melody, not to mention this contemplative bridge portion that really not only pulls at your heartstrings, but pulls you into the song and gets you kind of just wrapped up in this amazing piece of melodic beauty. It's an incredible song, and one that I know when I first heard it, I was just like, whoa, this is going to be a fun journey. I believe it's the title track of the album as well. So, well, let's keep going down the album line here. The next song that I want to select is a song called Tall Fiddler. And this is a song that, well, first of all, from a guitar standpoint, is awesome. But it has a really cool story that I'll share with you here in a bit. But first, let's listen to the song. So Tall Fiddler was written for Byron Berline. Now, this is really cool because it's kind of this cross-section of worlds for me because quite a few years ago now, I feel old, I worked for Weber Mandolins, which was at that time based here in Montana, and I would call around to different dealers selling mandolins. And there was this one dealer in Oklahoma. It was Byron's Double Stop Fiddle Shop, I believe, or Byron's Fiddle Shop. I can't remember the exact name, but I would call and I would speak to this individual, Byron Berline. And come to find out later, he's this incredible award-winning fiddler, and come to find out later that Tommy Emmanuel wrote this song for him. And in my notes here, it just says, flat picking, hi, how are ya? So I know Tommy's known as this amazing finger picker, which of course he is, but that is a great showing of his flat picking skills and just an awesome song. I believe it's out of a D position, and just his use of that chord position along with flat picking is so cool to see. Let's move on to the next song on my list. And this is another song that was dedicated to another amazing guitar player. The song's entitled The Man with the Green Thumb. And let's give it a listen, and then I'll share with you the story about the song. So that song was written for Chet Atkins. In fact, in the song, not only does Tommy mimic Chet's style, but he also even cites a little Merle Travis line at the beginning of the bridge, which is so cool. And altogether, I think it's just a beautifully composed song. It has this wonderful bouncy rhythm, and it's just one of those ones that by the end of the song, your foot is unconsciously tapping. It doesn't matter. You cannot listen to that song and not tap your foot. I dare you. It's a challenge. I'm going to throw down the challenge right now. Go ahead and try and listen to that song and not tap your foot. It's impossible. I've verified it. It's totally impossible. All right, moving down the list, we got two more songs left. And the next song I want to introduce to you is one that shows the power of the guitar, even though I think sometimes we associate powerful guitar with loud and fast. This song is not that, but it's just as powerful. Here's the song Angelina from Tommy Emmanuel's Endless Road album. So that's exactly what I mean. You can have this guitar that's not fast, that's not loud, but it can still pack a punch. And I think Angelina is that very song that exhibits that. It puts it on full display. It's a song that has beautiful phrasing. In fact, in my notes, I just put the power of phrasing. That's like a masterclass in how powerful phrasing can be in relation to a tune and its emotional impact. So Angelina is a fantastic tune. If you haven't heard it, make sure to hear the full version. In fact, for all of these songs, I'm just playing snippets, but if you want to see and hear the full versions, please head to acousticlife.tv/AT142. All right, the last song on my list, you might be thinking, is fast, it's loud, it's powerful. Well, it is powerful, but it is not fast. And it is not loud. In fact, it's probably the most sparsely arranged song on the album. It's called Mona Lisa, and here it is. This song is sparsely arranged guitar at its best. In fact, with this song, you can hear the bends, you can hear the harmonics, you can hear the articulation of the guitar, but more importantly, the space is equally as impactful as the notes in this particular arrangement. And I just love that. I love the guitar being able to breathe. I love feeling like you're in that same room with the guitar. And I think Mona Lisa off of Tommy Emmanuel's Endless Road album is a great example of space, sparseness, and just the power that the acoustic guitar holds. So there you have it, my five favorite songs off of Tommy Emmanuel's Endless Road. Why did I pick that album? Because it was the first Tommy Emmanuel album I ever heard. In fact, on his new album that was just released May 8th, The Best of Tommy Songs, he actually re-records some of these songs, and I'm just delighted. I've pre-ordered the album, and I cannot wait to slap it on my turntable because holy smokes, I'm so pumped. I am just beyond pumped for this album. Now, speaking of my favorite Tommy Emmanuel songs, his new album coming out, I want to know what your favorite Tommy Emmanuel song is. In fact, if you have a single song, put it in the comments below. If you have an entire album, you can place that in the comments below as well. I would love to compile this list of awesome Tommy Emmanuel songs for maybe folks that have never heard of Tommy Emmanuel and are looking for a one-stop place where they can select some songs that, well, are of note. So go ahead and list your favorite Tommy Emmanuel songs in the comments below. And speaking of comments, let's go ahead and hop in our time machine and head back to episode 140. Now, if you don't remember, let me jog your memory. In episode 140, we talked about John Prine and some amazing covers that were released after it was announced that he had passed. And then also, we had a very special announcement from some luthier friends of ours, just offering up some well wishes. And again, thanks to Brendan at Heartbreaker Guitars for that. I want to dig into some of the comments from that show because there was some great discussion happening. Our first comment comes from Dakota Covers, and they simply say this: possibly my most favorite episode about my most favorite artist. Thank you so much for this treasure of an episode. Well, thanks so much for watching, and I'm so glad that so many folks really dug the episode. In fact, so many great John Prine stories came out. I have a couple that I selected. One of our viewers actually met John Prine. So we'll get to that comment in a second, but let's head over and visit Thomas S. And he says this about the guitar gratitude that we featured: Beatrice seems lovely. I'm glad she's found a lift through the site and the community. It must have taken a lot for her to post her video, but I'm thankful that she did. She may have done it for herself, but I'm certain that she'll help others by having done so. May she continue to play and find solace in doing so. Thank you, Beatrice, for sharing something so personal. Safety and good health to all. Such a great sentiment. You know, those guitar gratitude pieces that we see more and more at the Acoustic Tuesday show, it is an act of vulnerability. And Thomas notices this and just says a nice public thanks to Beatrice. And I'll say thanks again to Beatrice as well. Let's go ahead and move on to our next comment. This comes from a longtime Acoustic Tuesday viewer, Jammy Billy. And he says this: unbelievable that all those great luthiers took time to send those messages to all of us here. Thank you. What a great idea from Brendan. Thanks to Brendan and Carly for thinking of us and putting this amazing video together. It really shows what a force for good that TAC and the Acoustic Live Show have become. Guitar geeks unite. Is that on a shirt yet? He poses the question. Not yet, but soon. Soon. Wink, wink, wink. I'm not really good at winking. I feel like my whole face contorts. But nonetheless, thank you, Jammy Billy, for watching the show. Thank you for the kind comment and the gratitude towards Brendan, Carly, and everybody at Heartbreaker Guitars who organized that luthier message. It was certainly uplifting. Our next comment comes from New York City from Lou A. He says, hey, Tony, Lou from NYC. Thank you so much for featuring John Prine, my favorite singer-songwriter. I remember about a year ago, I just spent an afternoon listening to his performances. Beyond his songs, his easygoing, humorous style make his performances like a novel you can't put down. I remember he introduced one of his songs and said, if you don't like it, don't worry, it'll be over before you know it. Aside from his amazing songs, he did some amazing covers. My favorite of his covers is Magnolia Winds, which he sings with Emmylou Harris. More recently, he turned me on to Killing the Blues as he made the song speak to me. His cover song choices and arrangements opens doors to songs I would have otherwise passed by. YouTube has a wealth of John's live performances. So cool. And I agree, it's so neat, you know, with the focus on John Prine covers last episode, I failed to mention some of the covers that John Prine actually did during his career. And it's so cool that Lou shone the light on that. So thank you very much, Lou, for sharing that comment and some of your favorite covers that John Prine did of other artists. Our next comment comes from Randy P. And this is a great story. And I was trying to trim down the comments and I saw this and I'm like, no, this can't be trimmed down. This has to be featured in full. So here goes nothing from Randy P. Hello, Tony. Great show today as always. I had the good fortune of meeting John Prine on a flight from Nashville to Minneapolis a few years ago. He was going to appear in Des Moines a couple days later. I didn't want to draw too much attention to him. So I leaned toward him and quietly said, have a great show in Des Moines. He looked at me, shook my hand, smiled, and said, thank you very much. His eyes twinkled and his smile was so genuine, I'll never forget it. I played a couple of his songs back in college while playing in an acoustic duo. I'm so happy to see so much support for his music and life at this time. I still play some of his songs and I'm learning more. Thanks again for a fantastic Acoustic Tuesday. Well, thank you, Randy, for sharing that story. And also kind of, I just love that. You can almost picture what happened. You know, you're on the plane, you see him, you don't want to draw the attention, you just kind of tap him on the shoulder and say, hey, have a great show. So cool. Thank you for sharing that. And then our final comment comes from Ukulele Travels, and you might be thinking, that screen name's a little odd. Hold on, I'll get to the point here. Thanks for the shout out, Tony. Loved helping out with those luthier clips. A super fun project. Always happy to be a part of the Acoustic Tuesday show. Carly from Heartbreaker Guitars. So cool that Carly watches the show. And again, a special thanks to her and everybody at Heartbreaker Guitars for organizing that awesome luthier video. What a stunning collaboration. And so cool to get some well wishes from some of the luthiers that we really admire as guitar geeks. And I just want to thank everybody for their comments back on episode 140, and of course all the episodes prior to that. Some of the comments and discussion and questions and just cool little things that are shared are so cool, and I really am humbled by the Acoustic Guitar Geek community that assembles here every single Tuesday to watch the show, but also just converse and connect with one another. In fact, there were a couple of recommendations on John Prine covers that I just want to share real quickly, a couple that stood out. Kevin Bacon and his wife covered In Spite of Ourselves. That was left in the comments. Brandi Carlisle performed some John Prine covers on Stephen Colbert's show, which I wanted to mention. Nathaniel Rateliff covered All the Best. Brandi Clark covered The Speed of the Sound of Loneliness. And also, I want to mention Acoustic Tuesday viewer Jess Jones, who recently released his EP, covered a John Prine song on it. Hello in there, one of my favorite John Prine songs. And then also, another comment came in just giving us an update on Oh Boy Record Label, the Oh Boy Record Label. In fact, that's the label that John Prine started. The update is this: Kelsey Walden is on the Oh Boy Record Label. And I want to thank Nick Neagle for that comment and that quick update. So cool to hear from you all. And as we continue down the Guitar Geek list, I do want you to know you can support the Acoustic Tuesday show. In fact, I want to draw attention to the Guitarsonal shirt that is located at AcousticTuesday.store. Once you go there, I want you to pick out the Guitarsonal shirt, pick your favorite color, get it sent directly to your door. Once you receive the shirt, put it on, gather up all your guitars, and take a picture amongst your guitars. Once you do that, you can submit it at acousticlife.tv. There's a submit link in the top menu, and once you do that, I'll feature you on an upcoming Acoustic Tuesday episode. In fact, not only have we been sharing the Guitarsonals here on the Acoustic Tuesday show, but we've also been featuring them on Instagram, and they've been garnering a ton of comments and a ton of likes, and it's just so cool to see everybody's guitar collection. I mean, it's just so awesome to see each and every Guitar Geek's Guitarsonal and hear the stories behind the guitars. It's just so cool and ultra geeky. Speaking of guitars, geeks, and, well, gratitude, because it's another G word, I wanted to throw it in there. I want to feature a guitar gratitude on today's episode. And this one, I have to say, maybe, you know what, I'm going to reserve comments. This guitar gratitude comes from Greg P. Talk about G's, right? Guitar geek gratitude from Greg. That's four. I'm pretty pumped about that. Solid alliteration, but let me kick it over to Greg P. here while he shares his guitar gratitude. Here he is.
One of the many reasons I'm thankful for my guitar is the beautiful people that I've gotten to meet because of it. One memory in particular is about my friend Dave. Dave used to work construction for me for a few years, and we didn't have a whole lot in common until we bonded over the guitar. From that day forward, we got to jam together, make beautiful music together, and really developed a great friendship because of it. I'll never forget one Thanksgiving I had him over for dinner, and he taught me my first pentatonic scale, which really propelled my guitar abilities. Unfortunately, 7 months later, Dave passed away after a quick battle with cancer, but I'll never forget that beautiful individual that I got to meet all because of the guitar.
Well, I want to thank Greg P. for sharing that guitar gratitude. In fact, in my notes here, I just said, just wow, dot, dot, dot. In 40 seconds, he manages to sum up the power and connection guitar can offer each and every one of us. And that's one of the things, as soon as that guitar gratitude came in fact, I downloaded the video immediately and shared it with the entire Acoustic Life team, because I was like, this is the magic of guitar. And I can't thank Greg enough for sharing that story and just submitting it and taking the time to submit it at guitargratitude.com. In fact, if there's a piece of guitar gratitude that you wish to share, please head over to guitargratitude.com. Once you're there, it'll prompt you to submit a video. You can do so right on that screen. It takes 60 seconds or less. In fact, you can even take notes on the screen if you get a little camera shy or if you want to make sure you remember some things. But once you submit that guitar gratitude at guitargratitude.com, I'll go ahead and feature it on an upcoming episode of Acoustic Tuesday. Quickly, before we get into our final segment of the day, which features a piece of gear that Tommy Emmanuel uses at every single live show, I want to send a special thanks to Colorado Kyle for making some high-octane coffee today. This is about my fourth cup, and I think I can actually fly at this point. I'm pretty sure before this fourth cup of coffee, I was like, man, I'm really feeling it today. Now I actually feel like I can fly. I'm not going to try it, but I'm pretty sure it's possible. My arms can move that fast. But also, I want to actually visit the mailbag. I had some arrivals. I wasn't going to share these, but then this came in. It completed the package. I'll explain. I got this card from Dr. Dave. And in his eagle card. Whenever a card like this shows up and there's an eagle on it, I'm like, oh, that's Dr. Dave. He says he hasn't written in a while, but I should be on the lookout for a package. And the package finally came. The package was completed because he sent some albums from the Fireside Collective. And I'm so pumped. Not only did he send some albums, he had the band sign it. And at the bottom it says, Compliments of Dr. Dave. So three albums to dig into here. And I'm super excited because I have been on a new music tear. Huge thanks to Dr. Dave. Huge thanks to Fireside Collective. I cannot wait to dig in. And I just love the little personal touch. And speaking of personal touch, some weeks back, I was dedicating some time to find some bands and artists that I liked and purchasing merchandise, because a lot of the artists that we know and love can't tour right now. So some of them might be in a pinch and they just need our support as guitar geeks. So I thought, you know, Molly Tuttle's an artist I really enjoy. So I figured I should order some Molly Tuttle merchandise. Of course, I've got all the albums, but what's left? Well, she's got some cool pins on her site. She also released this awesome shirt, and I was so happy to receive it. So yes, indeed. For those of you wondering why I haven't been mentioning Molly Tuttle on the show, I just first have to say I'm sorry, but I'll make up for it in today's episode. Yes, it's on Tommy Emmanuel, but I can mention Molly Tuttle a few times. In fact, there's a killer performance of Molly Tuttle playing White Freightliner Blues with Tommy Emmanuel on a cruise ship. I mean, it doesn't get much cooler than that. Now I got the shirt. I can fully be the Molly Tuttle fanboy that I've always dreamed I could be. Let me right the ship and bring us back into the actual focus of today's show, which is Tommy Emmanuel, which brings me to the final segment of today's show, and that's a focus on some gear. When I interviewed Tommy Emmanuel, and you'll find out if you watch that full thing, he uses AER amps. And AER amps are amps that I have admired for a long time. I haven't had a chance to try a ton until today. We'll get there in a second, but Tommy Emmanuel actually has a signature AER amp. And I found this wonderful video that actually shares his thoughts on the amp and kind of how he uses it in a live setup. So without further ado, here's Tommy.
Here's Tommy Emmanuel here, talking to you from Luxembourg. And I just wanted to tell you a little bit about my new AER amp. It's a Compact 60, but it has some delays from the initiation song. It has delays and reverbs in it. The two channels. It's kind of reworked, has a sweeter, bigger tone, and as a tribute to Australia and my growing up and my early beginnings, we've got a little artwork here, which is originally taken from my strap that was done for me a long, long time ago, and the artwork was Aboriginal artwork, and it was from the $1 note. That's how long ago it was. And it has my TECGP signature kind of thing here. So it's a special edition, and it's definitely improved, and the reverb is really sweet. And the delay is the imaging exactly of the Elesis MIDI verb that I used to use all those years ago. So that's what those good people at AER have come up with, and that's it. Hope you like it.
Now, I've heard that amp in action, and it is stunning. In fact, it's cool because a lot of the reverbs and things that you hear on his records are mimicked through that amp, and it's just so awesome to hear in person. Now, I've had the wonderful fortune to connect with the folks at AER Amps and not try just a single amp, but try a whole suite of amps. Yes, I had a chance to look at the AER Slope Compact 64, the AER Alpha, and the AER Compact XL. I brought them to my home. Now I want to bring you to my home, and we can, well, listen to these amps together. Let's take a trip. Here we go.
For all of you acoustic amp aficionados, have I got something for you today. Yes, today we're going to look at not one, not two, but three amps from the fine folks at AER. Yes, these are German-made amps, and although they come in a very tiny package, they pack a huge punch, as you'll find out.
The three amps we'll be looking at today are, starting on the left, the AER Slope Compact 64, then the AER Alpha, then the Compact XL. Now, you're also going to see that the Pocket Tools Colorizer 2 is included here. We'll get to that in a different video, but just know that it packs all of the EQ shaping power that's on the AER amps within a nice little convenient DI box. All right, let's kick things off with the AER Slope Compact 64. Just a quick look at the control panel here, you'll notice that each channel has a 3-band EQ, and then you have a global effects right there at the end next to the master. Compact little bundle of joy, the AER Alpha. A quick glance at the control panel shows two inputs, again a 3-band EQ, and then a non-switchable effects. Essentially, it's just a reverb that you can control the level on. Let's take a listen. Let's wrap things up with the big daddy, the twin channel Compact XL. Here is the Compact XL's control panel. You've got two channels, each with a 3-band EQ, switchable effects. You can also control the level globally. And then on the back, it really unlocks the power of this particular amp. You've got a DI out amongst many other options. Have it, three fine amps from the fine folks at AER. I want to thank the folks at AER for getting these amps sent here all at once so I could try them back to back to back. What an amazing opportunity to be able to try such high quality amps and just kind of detect the subtle nuances between each of them. Now, if I had to pick just one out of the lineup, I have to say I would go with the Compact XL. Now listen, I love the Alpha because it's a tiny package and a ton of sound comes from it. It's super portable and easy to use. And I love the Slope because it acts as a monitor. It actually aims the sound towards your ears, which is great in a performance setting. But for me, the Compact XL wins out because of its robust bass offering, its flexibility, its built-in DI output, which is fantastic, again, for performing, and again, the effects on board, and the overall sound production from this amp. I mean, it's still a tiny little box, but it can fill an enormous space. So all in all, I am way impressed with these amps, and I would encourage you to check them out as well if you ever get a chance. I think you'll be blown away at the transparency and the power in the AER amps. Cheers. Pretty awesome amps, no doubt. And one of the things I failed to mention in that particular review is that each of the amps comes with like a carrying bag. So not only are they convenient and tiny and powerful, they're really easy to move around from place to place, gig to gig, etc. Not to mention each of the amps features a DI out, which is incredible. And I'm just overall super impressed with those amps. And I never could believe that so much sound could come out of such a tiny package. And I'm talking about each and every one of those amps. Truly stunning. If you ever get a chance to try those out, please do so. I think you'll be really impressed. And another thing I want to mention, AER amps make dialing in your tone so easy. And I'm going to use the Mesa Rosette amp as a comparison here. I love the Mesa Rosette amp. I really do. But it has a ton of knobs on it. And if you have the time to sink into it, you can dial in a great tone because there's so many different parameters. And it's good for any tone tweakers out there, any people that want to have a ton of control, that's a great amp. On the other side of the spectrum are the AER amps. You've got a 3-band EQ, that's very easy to use and very easy to find good tone with. And that's one of the things that really kind of was top of mind as I was going through these AER amps is like, holy smokes, there's only three knobs, but the tone shaping capabilities are incredible. So I wanted to add that as well because I think those amps are just really expertly designed and I think every guitar geek should at least try one at some point. All right, I am ready to wrap up the show, and in doing so, we do have to visit our Guitar Geek trivia question. And yes, as you guessed, of course it's focused on Tommy Emmanuel. I mean, you've heard the question already, but just in case you forgot, it involves Tommy Emmanuel and the guitars that he favors. So, as a quick recap, here's your Guitar Geek trivia question. In which year was the Australian guitar company Maton Guitars founded? Was it A, 1946, B, 1952, C, 1959, or D, 1972? Go ahead and add your last guesses, because if you answered A, 1946, you're 100% correct. Until the mid-1930s, an Australian guitar manufacturing industry was virtually non-existent. Good quality guitars were hard to find, and at this time, the best guitars came from the USA. Bill May, a Melbourne-born jazz musician, woodworking teacher, and luthier, decided to change all that. During the early 1940s, Bill established a custom guitar manufacturing and repair business known as Maton Stringed Instruments and Repairs. This enterprise was so successful that Bill was able to convince his older brother Reg to join him as a full-time guitar maker, and in March 1946, the Maton Musical Instruments Company was born. To this day, the company is still 100% family-owned and operated and employs roughly 60 people. So cool. I actually learned a ton about Maton and doing research for that question, and I'm just blown away. I had no clue they started in 1946. For some reason, I thought it was in much more recent history that they started. But yes, 1946, pretty crazy, pretty crazy. A little another factoidal nugget that you can put as a feather in your Guitar Geek cap. All right, well, that's a wrap for today's Acoustic Tuesday show. But we should take a sneak peek into next week because I think if you enjoyed today's episode, next week's episode is going to totally blow your mind. Because next week on the Acoustic Tuesday show, the blues takes over. Yes, specifically, we're going to look at five blues guitars and not one of them exceeds the price of $250. Not one guitar I'm going to feature next week of the five blues guitars that I'm going to feature exceeds the price of $250. Yes, it's Budget Blues Guitar Week next week on Acoustic Tuesday, and I want to make sure that you don't miss this episode because it very well could give you a reason to grow your guitarsenal and not put out a ton of money for it. So that's all happening next week on Acoustic Tuesday. Remember, you can catch the Acoustic Tuesday, well, every single Tuesday at 10 a.m. Mountain Time here on YouTube. And of course, for your Acoustic Tuesday fix in between Tuesdays, please visit acousticlife.tv where you can do a deep dive on anything I've ever featured. Thank you so much for sharing your time with me today. Thank you so much for being a Guitar Geek. And remember, Guitar Geeks unite. Now I'm off to drink more coffee. Cheers.